Hi, I'm calling the meeting to order at 7:01 PM. Welcome to regular meeting number 1408 of the Wachusett Regional School Committee. This meeting is being recorded and broadcast on Holden TV Channel 194 and HoldenTV.com. Our first item on the agenda tonight is public hearing. Is there anyone who signed up for public hearing tonight? Do you have the list? It's up there. Thank you. Go ahead, Laura.
Thank you. My name is Laura Ibarra, and I'm a resident of Holden. I'm incredibly concerned about the life-threatening allergy policy as presented. I've appeared before you now several times and have attended most of the subcommittee meetings regarding this topic. I know you may be growing tired of hearing me speak, but as a parent who is advised by an administrator that our district does not do 504s for food allergies, I cannot stress its importance. On my son's fourth day of kindergarten, he had an allergic reaction and needed to be picked up. We need to keep our children in this district safe. The concept of a policy supported by more detailed procedures is great. However, if the school committee is removing protections from the policy, they need to ensure that these protections are covered appropriately in the procedures. This is currently not the case. I've outlined at our prior meetings how our current policies and procedures do not meet the minimum requirements of the law, yet no changes have been made. The Massachusetts Department of Elementary and Secondary Education provides detailed guidance on managing life-threatening allergies in schools. When I first learned about the changes to this policy way back in November at this point, I shared an email from the president of the Asthma and Allergy Foundation of America, the New England chapter, expressing her concern about what was happening in this district and providing resources. This guidance was one of those resources provided. Taken directly from the cover letter written to, by the commissioner to superintendents to all districts in Massachusetts, the manual provides school districts with guidance to create or revise written policy, manage situations as they arise, and foster dialogue for supporting students with life-threatening allergies. These guidelines are what BSEA hearing officers and PRS investigators use to determine if a district is in compliance with best practices. This should be our guide. They have done all of the work for us already. They created a task force comprised of professionals in the area of life-threatening allergies. Why are we trying to reinvent the wheel when guidelines already exist? Our protocol should mirror this guidance. One example, there's an entire page in the guidelines dedicated to training, an entire 8.5 by 11 page. Our protocols simply state, provide training for LTA and EpiPen training for all staff twice a year. It needs to be expanded and spelled out. I've also talked about inclusion. Children with food allergies often feel excluded. They have to bring their own pizza and cupcakes to birthday parties. They aren't able to eat out at restaurants or go on a play date after school or on a whim without a lot of planning. And there's a psychological component to life-threatening food allergies. It's not just physical. Bullying and efforts to educate all students and provide inclusion opportunities are expressly stated in those DESE guidelines. But it's now being removed from the policy and it's missing entirely from the protocols. Language choice is also important. DESE refers to their guidelines as managing life-threatening allergies in schools. Our district chose to refer to our protocols as managing students with life-threatening allergies. Children aren't something that you manage. They didn't ask to have food allergies, and believe me, every single day, their families wish they didn't have them. Please update this language so that the 822 kids in our district, representing 12% of our students, don't feel like keeping them safe is a burden. We need a solid policy. We need strong protocols. I've shared that with the subcommittee. And if there was a strong set of protocols that mirrored these DESE guidelines, along with the policy that referenced the components of those protocols, that would be an improvement to the current plan that we have in place. But what's being proposed really sets us back in time and puts students with life-threatening allergies at risk. I encourage you to move this policy back to subcommittee and involve families in this process that live this experience each and every day. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. The next speaker is Lindsay Lucasen.
Good evening. My name is Lindsay Lucasen, and I am a resident of Holden. I'm here to address the proposed changes to the life-threatening allergy policy and to stress the importance of maintaining meaningful family engagement practices in policy development, a crucial element we all recognize here as vital to student success. When examining the process behind this policy change, we must view it through the same framework of collaborative family engagement practices we strive for in our schools every day, especially for policies that affect our students' health and safety and address issues that may be beyond our own lived experiences. We need to keep our feet rooted in fostering true partnerships and shared responsibilities. Just as we value inclusive practices in education, we must prioritize collaborative family engagement to ensure all voices are heard and respected in our policy decisions. The rewrite process of the life-threatening allergy policy does not address the concerns raised by key stakeholders, parents, teachers, and students themselves. Simply put, where is their voice in this policy? A policy designated without adequate stakeholder involvement can lead to oversight and gaps in safety measures. Parents and teachers are at the front lines, managing these allergies daily and the understanding of the nuances and potential risks involved. Their insights and experiences are invaluable. When we don't use their input in a collaborative way, we risk implementing measures that might not adequately protect our children. When we fail to collaborate meaningfully, we send a message to our children that with life-threatening allergies that their safety and well-being are secondary considerations. This can create an atmosphere of anxiety and inclusion, which I know is the opposite of what anybody here wants. By engaging in meaningful and collaborative dialogue with all stakeholders, we can develop a policy that not only meets its safety requirements, but also fosters a sense of community, which is something we so desperately need. I urge this committee to reconsider the proposed changes and initiate a thorough, inclusive process that involves all stakeholders. Let's work together to develop a policy that truly supports health, safety and well-being of our students with life-threatening allergies. In doing so, we will take a significant step towards a more inclusive and supportive educational environment for all. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, moving on to Chair's opening remarks. I'd like to start tonight by reading an email from Chair Haber. Dear school committee members, this weekend I fell and severely injured my leg, which will require surgery. I will not be able to fulfill my duties as chair for at least the next couple of months, so it seems only right that I step down. As per our bylaws, Scott Runstrom will take over as chair. At the next meeting of the committee, you will elect a new vice chair. It is my intention to remain on the committee and participate as much as I am able for the remainder of my term. I ask that this be read into the record at our next meeting. Sincerely, Sherry Haber, Chair, Wachusett Regional School Committee. So I'm back as chair. I will do my best to serve the committee for the next year. Okay, just a couple more things. I was able to attend Wachusett graduation last Thursday, which was awesome. I just wanted to say it was a good experience for me, and congratulations to all of our graduates from Wachusett. I'm looking forward to seeing what you'll do in the future. My only additional note is about the next school committee meeting. We will have a meeting on Monday, June 24th. That is the first annual, hopefully annual, summer retreat. Much like our budget retreat in January, this will be an informal meeting and not televised because we're planning to have some informal discussions and maybe some breakout rooms that won't work well for TV. It is a public meeting, however, if anyone from the public wishes to come, they may. The plan is that we'll discuss some goals for the year, including a schedule of presentations that we'd like to see from administration and some operating protocols for the committee for this upcoming year. That's it for me. Our first order of business now for the meeting is to elect a new vice chair. So are there any nominations for vice chair? Jana?
I'd like to nominate Member Simon Garrett for vice chair.
Second.
I have a nomination for Member Simon Garrett. Are there any other nominations for vice chair? Hearing none, we will move to a vote by paper ballot as specified in our bylaws. In your red packets, you should have a yellow and a blue form. Let's start with the yellow form. Please name the candidate that you want to vote for and sign the form. Now read the ballots. Member Kaminsky abstains. Member Poole votes for Member Salmon Garrett. Member Salmon Garrett abstains. Member Brennan votes for Member Salmon Garrett. Member Kirschenbaum votes for Member Salmon Garrett. Member Dubois votes for Member Salmon Garrett. Member Gustafson votes for Member Salmon Garrett. Member Woodland votes for Member Salmon Garrett. Member Wallace votes for Member Salmon Garrett. Member Lavoie votes for Member Salmon Garrett. Member Runstrom abstains. Oh, yes. So I'm going to ask the people online now to please give your votes. Member Beardmore?
Beardmore abstains.
Member Lorway?
I vote for Member Salmon Garrett.
Member Winters?
I will also vote for Member Salmon Garrett.
Okay, thank you. Having tallied all the votes, we have elected Member Salmon Garrett as vice chair. The next order of business is executive session. I would accept a motion to enter into executive session to discuss treasurer and assistant treasurer candidates and contracts, as the chair deems a discussion in open session would adversely impact the district's bargaining position, to return to public session.
So moved.
Second.
Member Brennan and seconded by Member Poole. Roll call vote, please.
Member Beardmore?
Beardmore, yes.
Member Brennan?
Brennan, yes.
Member Dubois?
Dubois, yes.
Member
Gustafson?
Gustafson, yes.
Member Kaminsky?
Kaminsky, yes.
Member
Kirschenbaum? Yes.
Member
Lavoie? Lavoie, yes.
Member Poole?
Poole, yes.
Member Wallace?
Wallace, yes.
Member Winters?
Winters, yes.
Member Woodland?
Woodland, yes.
Vice Chair Salmon Garrett?
Salmon Garrett, yes.
Chair Runstrom?
Runstrom, yes. We are now in executive session. All right, we're now returning to public session. The next item on the agenda is the student representatives report. Our student representatives typically join us when the new school year starts, so we don't have student representatives currently. So we'll move on to the superintendent's report, and I'll turn it over to Dr. Riley.
Thank you very much, and thank you, Chair Runstrom, for stepping up again. We do appreciate it, and obviously we all have best wishes for a speedy recovery for former Chair Haber. And congratulations. So tonight's superintendent report, we're going to share a little bit about student news and celebrations. Chrissy Naiman, who is joining us from Houghton School, to talk about the work that teachers did with our curriculum department on updating our K-5 report card, provide a budget update, and really a thank you to a lot of our towns for their support this year, and then also offering an update on course offerings, specifically French at the high school. As the chair mentioned a little bit earlier, I just want to say congratulations to the class of 2024. Of particular note for me were the student speakers, class president Allison Deskins, Verena Welch, Isabella Giaquinto. Their speeches were outstanding. I can't say enough about their words, their maturity, their poise, and just did a really wonderful job and wanted to make sure I acknowledge that. I also want to give a special thanks to Christine Lynch. Christine is the assistant to the principal at the high school. Christine is retiring this year. She used to help and support our HR department. Graduation would not run without Christine Lynch. I don't know, is Bill here? Bill will echo that. It will be a bigger transition next year when Christine isn't there to plan graduation than it probably was this year when Bill wasn't available and Mike Pratt had to step in. She really does an incredible job. It is a huge function. It's an incredible endeavor for her to do what she does, and it always goes off without a hitch. So thank you, Christine. We will miss you and appreciate all your efforts for the district. Over your career here. Also, just want to say thank you and a nice job to Mike Pratt. Did a wonderful job stepping in. Mike gave a speech that was also very noteworthy. He had words of wisdom. I know my mother would appreciate it. Start your day by making your bed. But he really did a nice job. And then also, he broke our record and was able to. It's incredible when you can do a program, have multiple speakers, and end in slightly less than 2 hours. He really did an admirable job. Bill was angry all day today, and we finally figured out why that was. Bill was the former record holder. It really was a nice day all around. So congratulations to everyone involved, and congratulations especially to the students. It was a great group of kids. Also, just of note, we're going to start our middle school celebrations. They begin this Wednesday with Thomas Prince at the high school. Paxton Center School is on Thursday, Central Trees on Friday, and then both Choxit and Mountview will be holding their celebrations on Monday. Some updates for our athletic teams. Big congratulations. We have Division I state champions. The girls golf team brought it home. Absolutely incredible year, and good for them. Also want to acknowledge our girls softball team is in the Final Four tomorrow. They're going to be playing at Worcester State at 7 p.m. And then also of note, our girls flag football team in their first and not in their inaugural season advanced to the second round. They ended up losing to last year's state champions, Leominster, but pretty great for a first year club sport program. Also of note, we had two more teams win MIA Sportsmanship Awards. We also had the hockey team, which won an award in the winter. And I don't think we had won an award for several years. This is three awards that our teams have won this year. Both the girls tennis team and the boys lacrosse team were honored. Give a lot of credit to Mike Pratt and then especially Athletic Director Jen Lynch, who's working with the programs and making sure that we're not only developing good athletes, but we're also developing young women and men of character. So good for them. And then lastly, our middle school championships are going to take place tomorrow here at the school. The softball game is Choxit versus Central Tree and take place at 3:30. And for baseball, Central Tree will be taking on Mountview at 4:30. So at this time, I would like to invite Chrissy Naaman to come and talk to us about some of the work that they've done in support of our K-5 report cards. I know Laura DeRose and Amy Norton here as well.
Hi there, my name is Christina Naaman. I am a teacher at Houghton Elementary School in Sterling. I live in Rutland with my four kids. I have two fourth graders, first grader, child at the ECC. Some of my kids have special needs, and some of my kids have participated in the substantially separate programs at the district. And I mentioned that to you as somebody that grew up in the Wachusett District, grew up in Holden, and all of these connections have made this community really important to me. And one of the issues this year that has been extremely important to me is finding the most appropriate way to communicate effectively with families regarding their children's educational progress. And as a parent, I've been able to partake in these parent-teacher conferences and report cards and things like that over the years. And in participation with some of the curriculum groups, we've been able to kind of head this off. So we're going to go and see some background information onto why we needed to revise the report cards and then where we're at with the K to 5 report cards. So we moved to standards-based report cards over a decade ago. I was on that original committee way back when at Central Office, and we had our paper copies of the Common Core standards that had just come out, and we were handwriting out the ones we thought were most important because they couldn't all make the report card. And at that time, we did the best we could with the information that we had. And the information that we had was slightly limited at that time. We know over the course of years, we learn more, we get more experienced, and in doing so with our knowledge as elementary teachers, we have realized that our report cards are in desperate need of revision. It has been way too long since we have looked at these. Conversations have taken place with families anecdotally over the years via parent-teacher conferences and things like that. We've noticed areas where there has been confusion for parents regarding certain standards on the report card. We've noticed areas that we need to kind of parse out more and spell out more, and areas that we need to combine and consolidate a little bit more so that the report cards are something that are more approachable for families. So this year, in conjunction with our curriculum that has changed and evolved, we rolled out the new iteration, Eureka Math Squared, as opposed to just Eureka Math, and we created a teacher leader group with that under the direction of Director DeRose, along with our inter-reading teacher leader group, which convened in the winter. And we kept realizing that report cards are frequenting these discussions. How are we going to be communicating the educational progress of our students to families in a way that makes sense? So Director DeRose allowed us to revisit the report cards. We created an initial working group, and this working group was rather small on purpose, just to get a bare bones draft of the report cards going. We did have representatives from grade levels K through 5. We looked at our current report card standards, and we noted the areas that have kind of been points of issue in the past. We then worked to revise those standards with some parent guardian friendly language and making sure that we are maintaining vertical alignment, which is something that we didn't consider initially numerous years ago, as it just wasn't at the forefront of the work at that time. And we wanted to make sure that the information that we're providing regarding kindergartners with, say, fact fluency then follows suit with first grade, second grade, and so on in a way that makes sense and that we can see the growth. So after this initial work was done, this report card draft, the bare bones draft, was provided to the inter-reading leaders and the math leaders, which comprise of about 40 or so people. And we all got together and then made more edits and changes to the drafts. We also had input informally with people at our respective buildings and grade levels to get that work done. When we felt that we had a pretty solid draft at that time, we then created a slideshow with a webinar to provide all elementary teachers the opportunity to see this in actuality. We were going to hold an open meeting, but realized that since not everybody would be able to make it, we wanted to make sure everyone had access. We also provided everybody a survey, so if their input wasn't heard, you know, in our first initial go-around, there was an opportunity to provide such input. Then we offered anybody who wanted to, that was an elementary teacher, to join our report card working group to review the survey input and create a revised and final report card draft, which is going to be presented to you momentarily. Our hope, with approval from everyone, is that we can utilize these revised report cards in fall of 2024. So some of the trends that we noticed, one of the biggest things that have become apparent over the past several years is the need to move from quarters to trimesters. And there's several reasons why this makes sense at the elementary teacher level. When we are looking at our STAR reading, early literacy, and STAR math assessments that we've been utilizing for a few years now, those are done in beginning, middle, and end of year. And so the data that we're receiving from those don't quite currently align with the grading quarters and marking periods that we currently have in place. In addition, our new reading curriculum, which will be rolling out in fall, has the HMH growth measure along with the AMIRA placement and benchmark assessments where students will be reading into the computer and being provided feedback. And those benchmark assessments also take place 3 times annually. So that would more directly align with trimesters. However, that wasn't the only reason why teachers felt the need to move to trimesters. Looking at a typical grading quarter, it's roughly 45 days. And especially in the first grading quarter at the elementary level, we know that students take a bit of time to acclimate. We have routines to learn, adjustments to be made, review to do. And although new curriculum is certainly taught in the first quarter, by the time that we reach week 8, just about, students have barely had enough time to practice before we're assessing them. And some teachers felt that the information that we're providing on the report card is not necessarily the most specific information for the students because we've not provided them the adequate time that they need. Moving to a trimester marking period would provide us 15 more academic days, which is 3 academic school weeks, for students to practice and grow with those beginning of the year skills to provide that information to families and really have some more solid data to provide to families at that time that's really reflective of their students' progress. With trimesters, we would still maintain 4 touch points per year. Previously, if you look on the yellow side, the quarters, grades K to 2 had a face-to-face conference in the fall and 3 report cards, and grades 3 to 5 had 4 report cards with no face-to-face conference. And although it doesn't state here, the ECC also consistently has had 3 progress reports, so to speak, and a face-to-face conference. So grades 3 to 5 is some crucial developmental years for elementary students. Instead of learning to read, they're beginning to read to learn. We notice a big jump in students in this these transitional years, and grades 3 through 5 teachers feel strongly that, you know, these face-to-face conferences were important. And so as those types of things have changed, we've realized that putting this all together in a trimester model would really make sense for us to provide the most accurate data to families and align with our testing windows that we're using for the district. We also looked at grading criteria. On the right side, you'll notice the current grading criteria, the 1, 2, 3, 4 in yellow, and on the left side is the blue proposed grading criteria. One of the very first things we wanted to change was way down at the bottom where you see the number 1. Currently, our number 1 grading criteria for the standard says needs improvement. We didn't feel like this was an accurate representation of our students. We hate assigning the value of you need to improve because that's not necessarily the case for students receiving the 1 in the score. It's not necessarily the case that students need to improve their work ethic and things like that. It could just be developmentally that a student needs a bit more support to reach a skill. So we felt that clarifying our language for the 1 to say needs substantial support would be more clear to families so that they knew what we were talking about and so that we weren't necessarily saying their child needed to do something different. As we've all heard, I'm sure, over the years, we say elementary kids are like popcorn, right? They're all popping at different rates. Eventually, we all get to the same place, but some might need more support in certain areas and timeframes than others. The next area to highlight is the 2 progressing towards proficiency. We wanted to add the indicator of a plus. We have noticed over the year at parent-teacher conferences, parents coming and saying, well, my child received a 2 again, so they've made no progress, and that's not necessarily the case either. Students have made progress, but they may not necessarily be proficient with the Common Core standard at that time. So having the plus indicator allows us to tell families that the child has made growth. They just are not yet consistently and independently meeting the expectations of that Common Core standard. And that brings us up to the top section. We previously had the proficient and advanced ratings of the 3 and the 4. We look to combine those in a little bit more clear language to say consistently and independently meeting or exceeding expectations. The rationale for that is the 4 that we currently have listed says consistently and independently exceeds grade level expectations. It is not the case for every single standard that we are assessing children at a grade level above the 1 that we are teaching. So that information is a little bit not representative of what we're doing in the classroom for all standards. So we were trying to make this work for all the standards that we are reporting on. Moving forward, the actual K-5 report card draft is within here, and I'm not sure on this how to click into that link. Maybe Barry can help. Thank you, Barry. Thanks so much. And then you might need to stand there to scroll a little bit. So scrolling down, you can scroll down to the K section. We're not going to go through this with a fine-tooth comb, obviously, at this point, but here are the general ELA and math standards and work habits for kindergartners. And as we scroll down, you'll notice that you could see the revised information for all of the grades 1 through 5 as well. We did not look at science, social studies, PE, music, art at this time. We were focused mostly on the math and ELA with the rollout of our new curriculum and more so aligning vertically the standards. So some of the areas we have combined to make more sense and use parent-friendly language, such as tells time to the nearest 5 minutes versus, you know, a big convoluted sentence from the Common Core document, which is what we had originally because that's what we knew at the time. So perhaps that information, if anyone is looking to read specifically into that, could be viewed at a later time. Moving on to our next slide, one of the biggest things that we felt was important with a revision to the report cards is how we're going to communicate this out to parents and guardians. How are families going to understand why we're changing the report card, what we're changing it to, and why the needs for those changes have taken place. So we have a couple of different avenues that we're hoping to reach families with. All elementary teachers have Meet the Teacher Night or Open House Night in September. So at that time, families who join for that event will be able to receive information directly from their teacher regarding this change. We also are hoping to have written communication, a district-generated document that all teachers will have the same document for, to be sent home in paper form with families that night and to all families, whether or not they were in attendance that night. Additionally, at the conclusion of the first trimester, when principals send out their school messenger to alert families that report cards are visible, we are hoping to once again attach that document so parents can reference that as they're looking at the newly revised report card. And of course, with the face-to-face conferences in October, this can be touched upon as well to remind families of these new changes. So that's just a very brief overview of kind of how we got to where we are. And definitely, I thank you for your time in allowing us to share this work with you.
Thank you. Any questions from the committee? Malia, George, and Melissa.
Oh, sorry. I want to thank you all for your work. This is quite detailed, and I appreciate all the effort that's gone into it. I do have a quick question. When you said that it doesn't include social studies and math, does the new 1 through 3 scale, does that apply to those fields, or are some subject areas going to have the new 1 through 3 and others have the old 1 through 4?
Sure. So the grading criteria of 1 through 3 would be applicable to all the standards on the report card. Okay. It's just the content of the standards was only revised for math and ELA at this moment in time due to our new curriculums rolling out. Okay. So it is the goal that this will be a somewhat living document, that we're not going to wait 15 more years to review it all. We do know that science and social studies need to be looked at, and perhaps PE, music, art, etc. This is kind of the first step in doing so. We didn't want to bite off more than we could chew and then have a job that wasn't, you know, fully vetted.
I appreciate that. We were here when you switched to the standard base, so it was a challenge. So I hope this is very logical to me, at least, and I hope it's well received. So thank you.
Thank you.
George.
Yeah, thank you. I find the change in the grading description to be unfortunate. The needs improvement is already a euphemism, and the move is in the wrong direction because, well, from the technical perspective, there is a difference between performance and the way the performance is achieved, and the grades are supposed to grade the performance. So this is a disservice to the students when they grow up. They will find out that this assessment is not what the real life really is. It would be much better to keep it at least at needs improvement in describing the grade, which is, you know, failing or clearly substandard performance. Thank you.
Thank you for your feedback.
Melissa.
Thank you very much for your presentation. It was well thought out. My only question is that how are teachers going to communicate the next steps for the next teacher if the student gets a 1 or a 2? Is there going to be a plan of action if a student needs improvement or is minimally progressing. Is there going to be a plan of action to minimize or kind of decrease the achievement gap?
So the achievement gap can be addressed via curriculum. This particular presentation is just on the report card standards and how we're adapting and changing those standards, not necessarily our tier 2, tier 3 type interventions. So I can't really speak to that at this moment in time, but it's definitely something that is being thought about.
Excellent, thank you.
Jim, do you want
to? Yeah, I can share a little bit to Member Wallace. And so one of the things we're working on this year as well is how we document what interventions we are using with students. And so with the Panorama dashboard, we kind of have created more of a living document in terms of what's being done with students and what's successful that will then travel with the student moving on. And teachers are going to be able to understand more historically what interventions, what types of support have been effective for the student. But we're continuing to definitely work on that. It's part of our MTSS work. And then the other thing I just would acknowledge to you is there's a need for us to continue to work on our transitions between grade levels and then especially between schools. And that's something that we certainly have identified that we want to get better at.
Thank you.
Matt? So a couple questions were, and this might be more for the superintendent, but you mentioned transition to school. So I think of the tail end of this and then the migration to middle school. I'm not sure if we have a consistent policy or procedure of leveling students in middle schools, but I have heard that some schools like to level students. And I have concern with just a proficient rating versus having an advanced rating. I do think that does allow for us to identify students at all different levels, and I do have a fear that proficient is an area that will be a large grouping and will miss that opportunity to really identify how students can really progress at the next level as well as the K through five. So how have we thought about that end cycle and assessment and what that looks like in transition?
So, I mean, the piece I'd speak to is what Chrissy had brought up earlier tonight, in that right now, the rating system that we were using, we didn't feel, or the teachers didn't feel, was accurately assessing what the students were actually capable of. And it was kind of a false narrative from what I heard tonight, in that people were getting beyond proficient, but there weren't even standards that they could actually judge that on. I think this is a true representation of an actual standards-based report card, to be honest with you. And really the goal in elementary school is to get these students to the proficiency level where they can access all of these students. I'd echo kind of similar to what I was saying to Member Wallace, Member Lavoie, in that another thing I think we're really looking to concentrate on in the district is providing opportunities for all students, right, whether they need additional support or they have achieved and are ready for extensions to their learning. And I think that's why we're actually trying to work so much to develop these kind of periods where we can either teach and enrich or support. It's another need in the district, absolutely. I'm confident that not only, and one of the things I'd say about this piece, which I'm very thankful for, and I honestly think this is a great example of teachers being able to advocate, being supported by the curriculum department, doing really good work. I personally feel like this is incredibly thorough and well done. But we definitely have next steps that we need to take. You know, besides the other areas that need standards, we also do need to work on our schedule, how we support students, and then I don't want it to be lost, how we challenge students who are ready for perhaps, you know, that next step, more rigor. But I'm confident and I'm hoping next year we can actually share with the committee how we're able to look at some of our schedules and provide those opportunities for all students.
So my other question is, touching upon that other student. So students on IEPs that might align with a traditional four semester report card structure, how are we looking at that as we look at 2024?
So I'd say pre-K to two, it won't be any difference from what they had before. The change will be in grades 3, 4, and 5. I think similarly, I would say for the reasons why the teachers thought it was such a good idea to adjust their marking period for the report card, I would say similarly, during that first time period, they're really getting to know students and don't have a full confidence in the assessment that they would make for students. I'm hoping that with these three terms for those grade levels, you'll actually have a more viable, accurate document that communicates what the child student is truly capable of. I think the other added bonus, and I really don't want this to be lost, is teachers and parents are now going to have an additional face-to-face interaction when they can actually talk about students and all students. You know, that's students on IEPs and students who aren't on IEPs. And our hope is, and we won't know this, but my hope is that parents will find that even more informative and helpful. For them in knowing the teacher who's spending time with their child. I'd say for all this stuff, and Chrissy said it well, you know, this is iterative. We're not, you know, we're doing a part of it. Felt like it needed to be done. I honestly respect them a lot for saying, look, there's some urgency. We need to do something about this and start the work. 12 years is a long time not to have done anything about this. But I'd also say that with the conferences and with the report cards, there's going to be a process where we're also getting back some feedback and knowing, okay, did this more successfully communicate your child's level of support or need or what they're actually accomplishing? Same thing with conferences. You know, I think we're going to be reaching out and saying, how was that? Did that work? What would you like more? You know, one of the things with the conferences, I'd acknowledge they're going to be shorter in duration than I think we would like, but I was just thankful that the teachers worked with us to have this opportunity to have face-to-face. I think it's one of those things that if you're a parent between 3 and 8th grade, I can't imagine of another time where I would be desperate to know how my child is doing. And so I'm glad that we're going to have that opportunity in district next year.
Thank you. Linda and then Paul.
So I want to thank you again, and this makes a lot of sense. I have to admit I was skeptical seeing the forest coming off. I'm going to be a little bit heartbroken to see the four is coming off of my kids' report card, but that's a me problem. So I think that my question really, though, is for administration, but I wanted to be sure to thank you for that. So, and it's only about, in terms of administration's load in managing trimester for K through 5, but quarters for the other grades, and if that poses any red flags to administration on that side of it, or if it's really just part of the system anyway. And
it's going to be it'll be more unique for our K-8 schools, specifically elementary schools. It's actually probably a little bit easier because they were negotiating both before, and now it's only one common expectation. But I think it's like all things. We actually saw this presentation, I think, one or two principal meetings ago. And it was universally accepted. I mean, I think people felt like, oh, this is a step in the right direction. And the one thing, and I understand the point people are making and that they really want as much information to try to understand where their child's at, but the emphasis I understand from a lot of the work that they've done is to hopefully more accurately and completely communicate what they're hoping for students and what their progress looks like in classrooms. And so I'm hopeful that that's going to be accomplished. But I think we got to reach out and say, hey, you know, we hit the mark, or we have to go back to the drawing board, and is this successful, or what do we need to rethink? But yeah, it's change is hard.
Paul. I just wanted to echo Dr. Riley's sentiment and commend you on this really ambitious effort. You know, when I'm listening to your presentation, I'm hearing that you guys are engaged in something that's really complex, yet needs to be communicated clearly to parents who might not know the standards. You're also trying to get a large group of people to agree on something that is very specific and that people care about a lot. There's a ton that goes into work like this, and to do it in two different content areas is incredible. So I wanted to start by commending you and the thought that you put into it. It's really clear, you know, switching to 1 through 3, you know, with the language around 1 shows a lot of thought in tying into the district goals. When we talk about communicating positively with parents around the need to support their students. That's exactly what we're telling them. This, you know, if you get a one on a report card, the solution is right there. We know that we need to support your student. Oh, and by the way, our biggest district goal is around MTSS. And so we're going to be there to support your student. And so I just wanted to commend you for the hard work and really having the broad interest of the district at heart.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much. Really appreciate it.
So wanted to move on a little bit for a budget update. You know, really, this was a time we're going to be entering into our fifth town meeting tomorrow in Princeton. And I've been reflecting on our partnership with the town and the work that and the partnership that they have agreed and worked towards with us. And I just felt it was of note. And I wanted to talk about it a little bit tonight. The FY25 budget process has been challenging for all of us, I think, as a committee and as a district, in that we have so much that we know we want to accomplish. And some of those things are related, obviously, to the resource of funding. But for our town partners, they were asked to support a budget with very high numbers. And that's a challenge as well. And a lot of this was driven by a level of Chapter 70 support that did not continue as it did last year. We've spoken publicly about the increase last year was $3.4 million. The increase this year so far on the budget is $200,000. That's an incredible shortfall. And for us to maintain our staffing, and that really was the primary drive for us during this budget, was to maintain our staffing. I mean, we're continuing looking to where we can support where our needs are by making difficult decisions. But we know when you look at the data, we don't have staffing levels that reach the state average. And so we felt that was very important. And I think by and large, our towns have responded to that message, and I just wanted to thank them. And we had a lot of work to do. You know, it's been three meetings, so I'll praise Michelle Grise again as finance director. Michelle has done, she told me earlier today, she's on her fourth, you know, starting her fourth audit in less than a little bit more than a year and a half, and has done an incredible job addressing our financial deficiencies. But we had them. We had a lot of financial deficiencies, and our town partners have been patient as we worked those out, and I think they've recognized that, and especially recognized the work that Michelle did. And so I just wanted to talk about a few of the towns and just the support that they've given us. In Paxton, the town meeting on May 6th, their select board supported our budget, and that passed despite the need potentially for an override. Paxton's also the first town that got us on our security improvements. They passed. I remember it was my first month here as superintendent, and they had a special town meeting to finance security improvements in the school. And I'm happy, as you'll see as we move along in this, that all of our schools will have the security improvements that I think we all felt was so desperately needed when we started our tour of facilities under Member Woodland. In Sterling, in town meeting on May 6th, their select board also supported our budget, and I'd like to thank them for their support. And honestly, of all the towns, Sterling has been a leader in terms of making improvements to their physical plant. They did floor replacements in FY23. It was, I think, the only town and school that had committed to a project that year. Security improvements this past year, and they're looking to support a phone and intercom system upgrade this next fiscal year. In Rutland, in the town meeting on May 11th, both their FinCom and Select Board supported our budget. They also found a way where they're going to be supporting their security improvements in FY25, which was very much appreciated. And they themselves, much like Paxton, are struggling with budgetary issues and had to pass a override last year. In Holden, town meeting was held on May 20th. Both their FinCom and Select Board voted to support our budget. Holden this year has done incredible, given us incredible support for our facilities, between modular classrooms being added in Dawson and in record time, and a special town meeting to improve that, and then the FinCom support for that initiative. Security improvements and playground revitalizations, are going to be supported next year. And that's needed but very much appreciated work. And they did a lot of work to make sure that that could get passed. And then we moved to Princeton and they have their town meeting tomorrow. Their advisory council, which usually takes a detailed look at all of the budget needs in the town. I shared in the superintendent's report a link to their recommendation. Honestly, I wish I had seen it before we did our budget presentations because Michelle and I were laughing. It was really that well done, both to give the context of what our funding has been traditionally, but then also why the increases have been at the level that they have been. So I would very much like to thank them for that support and then also for that commentary for voters to see tomorrow night. Princeton is another town that has consistently supported the school. They had door lock upgrades my first year here in FY23. They are putting in security improvements this fiscal year. They also, we haven't talked about it, the general community replaced a water tank and pump replacement this fiscal year. So they really have been another just great partner working with us this year, and just want the town to know that we appreciate it. At this time, I don't know if anybody has questions about budget or town.
Any questions about the budget?
Nope. Go ahead. So finally, wanted to talk a little bit about course offerings, and we talked last committee meeting. There had been some information put out that people had concerns about French being canceled. And at the time, I wasn't really prepared to talk about it because it wasn't something that the administration had actually communicated even to me as superintendent, because they were actually in the process of looking at solutions and what needed to be done to address the issue. I think one of the things that's a challenge at times in the district is that things take on a life of their own, and you're not always able to control what gets communicated. And when you don't know because you're not ready to communicate yet, you find yourself in a solution-focused area where you're just trying to figure out what the right thing to do is. And I think that's really an issue that the high school inherited in this case. Provided a little bit of a narrative in the superintendent's report, but what I would want people to understand is that there was concern about the original French enrollment at the high school. And in particular, there were a couple classes that, at least in the original enrollment pattern that they ran through high school, there was, I think, three and one in French 4, although that was divided under different levels of rigor. And then there was also one student who had signed up for AP French. I think these are a couple of things I would want to share about this. French, like as a language, is a continuation of a course of study. And we wouldn't want to, as a district, to ever turn our back on kids who have started that language process. And I think we do owe all students that if they started their course of study, they should be able to finish at the high school. It would not have been proper for us as a district to say, well, you've put this in for 3 years. We're not going to have an option for you moving forward. That case said, I also, though, feel like, and we've talked about this before, we should be making responsible but then also thoughtful positions in terms of resources. And I think the high school was at the point of, can we offer this live? We may not be able to. And so what are some of the options that we have to, that we want to look into? But I do want to make sure that it's understood that this wasn't about not having a pathway for these students to continue. Unfortunately, the fact that the high school was looking at that was shared prematurely. And I think that caused a level of crisis, which I understand. I would have been upset if I was a parent. I would have been upset if I was a student. And I felt like my child wasn't going to have an opportunity that they should have. And so I understand the angst and anxiety that people were feeling. And I acknowledge I would have felt the same way if I was a parent. I also, though, can understand from the high school's point of view that to be asked to find a solution that they're not ready to proffer and to try to find out exactly what happened, they were put in an extremely difficult situation as well. Since the last school committee meeting, the World Language Department Head Lori Monteverdi has contacted all the students who might be impacted. And they did a couple of things. First of all, they reached out to make sure and to verify that students, because although the initial enrollment was quite low, eventually there was a more an increased amount of students who said they were interested in looking at some of these courses. And so Ms. Monteverdi reached out, asked students about a couple of different options, including online options, and seeing what their interest level would be, and then also an interest level about potentially combining some of the students, even between French 4 and AP French, which is something that they had looked at previously. The other work that the district has done is they looked at the cohort information. You know, this happened in Latin a while ago, but I think there's some important distinctions between Latin and French. With Latin, and this is my understanding, is historically there was a continual decline in students who were interested in taking Latin. It's not necessarily the case with French. And so this is, and we had a parent actually, I think, who spoke about this last time they were here. This is just one particular cohort that is much smaller than the classes behind them. And I do feel like that's an important point, because it's one thing if you're trying to make instructional decisions or course offering decisions based on a steady decline, where eventually the district has to make a decision, okay, does this course pathway, is it viable? And I think in this case, when we've looked at it, there are higher numbers at lower grade levels, which kind of put a twist on how I think we want to approach this issue. And I think this is the work the high school's doing right now, because you wouldn't want to offer a substantially different experience for students just because they were part of a cohort that's smaller than previous cohorts. And so I know this is the work the high school has done. I know they're going to be communicating ultimately where they land to families this week. I have to say, I have an extreme high level of confidence in both Mike Pratt as building principal, and then certainly in Lori Monteverdi as the World Language Department chair. They both think about kids first, and I am confident that they're going to land in a place that leaves these kids and families supported. You know, it's hard for me because I don't think in this particular case that the district miscommunicated something. However, I have to say, I feel badly for the students and families who were impacted. I know this caused angst, and I wish that had not happened. And you know, we continue to think about, this is something, and actually I had a conversation with a committee member about this, as I think that as we have a declining enrollment at the high school, I think we have to think about and be thoughtful about how do we handle situations like this, even when they're one-off, which is honestly what they were thinking they were doing. I just don't think they were expecting such a low number to initially subscribe. But it is, some of this stuff is on our strategic plan, looking at our schedule, looking at our course offerings, looking to develop courses that are going to have more real-world learning experiences for kids and may explore pathways that commonly students haven't been able to explore here. But I think with that, we also have to look at all of our courses and make sure, A, we are giving kids what they need and what they're interested in, and then also in a case like this, making sure that we have a guaranteed way to provide a course of study for students in an area like a world language. I think the other thing that I just want to acknowledge, and I didn't say this earlier and I should have, I think the other thing that we found out during this process is the online components offer substantially different experiences, whether it's French 4 or French 5. I think with French 5, it's more interactive and you'd have an actual class, and that's not the case for French 4, where it would be more of an online component. And so that's another issue that I think when the district considers that, they're going to weigh heavily in making this decision. And so I just want to acknowledge all that, but I also want to be really careful as superintendent. I'm not making decisions that I have confidence that other people will make the right decisions for. So.
All right. Questions? George, go ahead.
Yeah, well, regarding this last topic, and well, it's certainly great that the issue is in the process of being addressed. That's very nice. There are two things, though, that I'm afraid have to be said. So first of all, the first issue is with the numerical data. So in the report, in the post-it report, page 2, for example, it lists one student registered for AP French. Now, as a member of the school committee, I received a number of emails from parents of affected students. The number is not one. I know of identifiable students who actually signed up for AP French. It was not one. There are stories like, for example, my son signed up in February. Power school did not work. Counselor and chair of the department assured him that he will be registered manually, and yet even as late as last week, he was told that he is not registered. It was only 2 days. For one student, it was 2 days that his desire to take AP French was actually recorded. That's thing number one. Well, thing number two, again, I know more than one student. I do have an email from Dr. Riley that at least 7 students registered for AP who wanted to take AP that was dated May 22nd. And in view of all that, my question would be, and by the way, I understand that, well, Dr. Riley is the superintendent, so that's, it's probably the high school administration, Mr. Pratt, who is to blame, but is it fair to have in the report, to have the only numerical number for AP French as 1? Or is it really 1? Should it be 7? Should it be somewhere else? What is the actual number now, and what should be the fair number? Fairly listed number for the students who desire to take AP French by the time, well, when we're still allowed to sign up for it. So what would be the number?
So, sorry, I'll start from the beginning. And so what I shared with you were the numbers that were reported by the high school upon initial enrollment. Okay, initially these are the numbers that they saw in Power School, which made them concerned about their ability to offer the course. After that, and I do feel like this was in the superintendent's report, additional students applied to the class. And those are the numbers reflected in the email that you referenced. The numbers, and I actually said this in the superintendent's report as well, Member Kaminsky, is that those additional students who registered were accepted, and we actually have reached out to them and said, if you're truly interested, sure. And so I can't speak to the Power School issue. I can only tell you that they've looked at it, and these are the numbers that they've reported to us, okay? And the numbers that I shared with you, those were the later numbers after students, I guess, got into the system and applied for it. I'm certainly not questioning anybody's process or whether they applied for a course or not. I'm simply sharing the data that the high school had available to it, and then the data I had available to me when you had asked that question. And so it's honestly, that's what was reported tonight. That's what the high school had for data, all right? I'm sorry, I lost the second part of the question. In terms of what number would be reached, I think a lot of it depends on the options that can be available. Do I understand, this example was given in the superintendent's report as well. I believe it's AP Physics, and that they've gone back and forth on what they're able to offer. And at times, they have enough students subscribed where they feel like they can offer the course, and at times, they don't feel like they can. The difference, I think, a little bit between physics and world language, though, is that course of study, where, you know, I think it's more understandable that you may not have an option for students if you can't hold a live AP Physics class, and that's not necessarily the same when you have a world language. We asked the high school actually today about if they're aware of issues with Power School, and they're not. I'm not saying that didn't happen. I can't, certainly not saying that parents or students aren't telling the truth, but that doesn't mean that the high school's not telling the truth either, right? And so I think that's where I would want us to be careful.
Matt, and then George again.
Do you want to follow up? Or?
I don't know.
Oh, yeah, and so the second thing, well, which is related. Oh, so may I?
Yeah, go ahead, George. Yeah.
So it's the narrative that's presented in the written report, which basically blames a teacher, well, teacher not identified but is identifiable, for providing wrong communications to the students. Now, I'm surprised, honestly, because first of all, well, this teacher apparently is not allowed to present the their side of the story, so we just have to assume that they are to blame, again, without any opportunity to defend the information that was distributed. But even more importantly, I think it, I mean, it insults my intelligence. I mean, Mr. Pratt is the principal of the school. If a teacher communicated wrong information, it would be very easy for the principal to communicate information to the students and their parents involved in this story and say what is the real situation. This did not happen. In fact, well, like I said, I received a number of messages from affected parents. From what I understand, some of them sent emails to the principal specifically, and their emails were not even dignified with an answer at all. And the way things are proceeding today, again, the thing has been fixed, again, without any communication as to, well, yeah, well, we understand there was a misunderstanding and now things are getting better. It looks like nothing happened. Yeah, well, you're just enrolled and this is fine. And I see this as an attempt to shift the blame and to completely avoid any responsibility. Well, I don't know which part of the administration, the school, or the, excuse me, the district. And together with the number one student registered for like AP class in the numerical table, I see this as an attempt to, well, clumsy attempt to tell a story that doesn't hold water.
I find it ironic, Member Kaminsky, that you would make a statement saying that we're trying to blame a teacher for a situation. When I was here at school committee last week, or last time we were together, I feel like all the blame was actually placed without knowledge of what might have happened. I don't think anybody's trying to excuse anything. I think they're simply trying to say, share the data and what actually happened in this case. If you don't believe it, then you don't believe it. It troubles me, though, that it's okay for people to make grand pronouncements or say things that aren't true or half true and blame the district, and that's acceptable. It's not. It's not. And I'm not trying to blame a teacher. I'm not. But what I am trying to acknowledge, what I'm trying to acknowledge without the drama, okay, is the fact that something was communicated to an adult, and that adult shared that information in a way that created a great deal of anxiety. And I wish it hadn't happened. However, two charges I heard from the committee last time we were together. One was to give an update of where we are in the process and what happened. And then also I was asked to respond on what was communicated to who and how. And I felt like if that's what I'm asked to do, that's the information I should share. And that's what I tried to do, okay? And that's why I did what I did. I'm not trying to blame everybody, anybody, but this is what happened.
So just then one clarification. So did Mr. Pratt at any point try to talk to the, to communicate to the parents of the students and tell them, you know, hold on, don't get involved in any drama, we're working on this? Has this happened or not?
I am not aware of his personal communication with any parents. I don't know.
All right, Matt.
So, Dr. Riley, I appreciate this being in the superintendent report. So I'm going to call out a few things. I forwarded a letter, or had Randy forward a letter to this body prior to our last meeting from a student. And to your point, that student was contacted last week. Last Wednesday was the first time they heard about French class and French 4. So despite enrolling in that class, despite sending a letter to this body, first time they heard was last Wednesday, less than 5 days ago. And in their conversation with Ms. Monteverdi, Ms. Monteverdi acknowledged there was a huge impact to their college path if they were not allowed to continue down a path of French 4. I think this is important because you acknowledged in your statement that all students should have an equal opportunity for a course of study and a path. These decisions that were prematurely made are in direct violation of our equity policy that this school committee has, talking about a student's offering. The other thing that I'd like to call out in that conversation that Ms. Monteverdi had with the students, questions were asked, solutions were not provided. Questions were asked. Would you be willing to attend class with AP students?
The answer was yes, I would be willing to move up to that. I'd be willing to be in a live environment. The question was asked, would you be willing to take an online class? The student was smart enough to ask, what does that look like from my experience? And they were told, well, you might have to take it during your study period. The student challenged back and said, why wouldn't I take it during the design time block? There was no answer provided. It's finals week. Students are stressed out about tests. They still don't know what their future looks like. I bring us back to a statement that you made that we always think about the mindset of a student. How is a student preparing for an exam today if they have anxiety about the future and what that presents? Have we thought about that?
Can you, and I wish I had taken notes, Matt, because that was a long, can you just go point by point again, and I'm happy to give you responses. Because I think the first thing you were asking about was, and this is one thing I've tried to emphasize when I was given this report, there's a difference between not holding a live class and not allowing for continuation of a course of study. With Latin, the district offered virtual opportunities for students when we weren't able to have live classes for all the students. And so one of the things that's frustrating in terms of the rumor mill or was out there on social media was that French was being canceled, which I don't think had ever been considered for the high school. There's a difference between offering a course option that's not in person and offering one that might be virtual. And then what I would say is, no, I don't think people were asking people what the solution was when they contacted students. I think they were reaching out to students to see what their reaction would be if the district looked into certain solutions. Would it meet their needs? What would their concerns be? That's my interpretation of what that conversation looked like. And it's trying to gauge our students, what would their response be to an online learning platform? Would they be amenable to having these groups together and trying to offer in-person instruction in that manner? And so I think that was the purpose between all of those things. But I think the unfortunate piece about all this was that it was put out there that the French program was going to be canceled. And to my knowledge, that was never the intent.
And just to follow up, and that's my whole point, is inconsistent communication, that communication happened first time last week to a student, and we have to think about that. The other thing that I think is incredibly important is, as the leader of this district, a few meetings ago, we were presented with hour-long presentation as to why we should accept school choice. This information would have been super valuable at that point. When this body had the choice to decide whether or not we would give you the opportunity to perhaps let in a limited number of students. If it were, hey, this would save our French program and we can look at transcripts and make that decision, that would have been important to know.
Remember, LaFleur, you personally have said that you felt that presentation was a waste of time.
Because it didn't have facts on the impact of our district.
And if you actually look at that presentation and what was delivered to you, there was a lot of data, including declining enrollment at the high school and its impact. Look, I would love
to talk about the impact to the students, Dr. Riley, that a French course could be impacted. You did not even present that in any of that.
I'll be honest with you, and so I think that, and I had been asked this question before, when you look at when you offer courses, we should be doing so in a way that it's responsible use of the resources that we have. And so, I feel like the high school was going through a thorough process trying to find solutions. And I think fundamentally, the reason why there was anxiety out there was because somebody said something to students that they shouldn't have. And so I just want to acknowledge that. You can talk about the school choice presentation, and I would encourage people to go back and look at the data that Dr. Kroll gave you. And if I'm supposed to see the future and know that a French course may be undersubscribed a month after the school choice presentation is given, then you're giving me far too much credit.
You don't have access to what students have enrolled in for the next year?
No.
So when students say, I selected my course offerings, where does that selection go?
It goes to the guidance department.
and you don't look at that, to look at staffing.
All right. I think we're getting
I'm
off
topic. I'm concentrating on passing the budget, right. Member Lavoie, and we're going to be in a lot of trouble if it doesn't.
I think I want to move on. I think we've covered the subject. I'd like to move on, please. It's good to know that there is going to be options for these students, and we're not canceling the French program. And that's my takeaway. So, yeah, let's move on. All right, so we're going to move on to recommendations requiring action by the school committee. We actually have a consent agenda consisting of the following items: to appoint Stephen Presnell as treasurer of the Wachusett Regional School District, to appoint John Lumbra as assistant treasurer of the Wachusett Regional School District, to approve the contract of the treasurer, and to approve the contract of the assistant treasurer. Would anyone like any items removed from the consent agenda? Seeing none, we're ready to vote on the consent agenda.
We don't need to do first or second.
Oh yeah, we need a first.
For the consent agenda, do we? All right. Do I hear a motion to approve the consent agenda?
Second.
Seconded by Linda. All right, so let's move to a roll call on the consent agenda.
Member Beardmore?
Beardmore, yes.
Member Brennan?
Brennan, yes.
I'm sorry?
Brennan, yes.
Member Dubois?
Dubois, yes.
Member Gustafson?
Gustafson, yes.
Member Kaminsky?
Kaminsky, yes.
Member Kirschenbaum?
Kirschenbaum, yes.
Member Lavoie?
Lavoie, yes.
Member Lorway?
Lorway, yes.
Member Otmar?
Otmar abstain.
Member Poole?
Poole, yes.
Member Wallace?
Wallace, yes.
Member Winters?
Winter, yes.
Member Woodland?
Woodland, yes.
Vice Chair Salmon Garrett?
Salmon Garrett, yes.
Chair Runstrom?
The chair abstains and the motion passes. Moving on to unfinished business, we have no unfinished business tonight. We also have no minutes to approve tonight, so we have nothing in the secretary's report. We will have the minutes to the last meetings at the July meeting for approval. All right, moving on to committee business. I would accept a motion to adopt policy 1230, policy relating to school committee operations, subcommittees of the school committee, second reading, waiving the reading.
So moved.
Second.
Jana and Shannon. Any discussion? George.
Well, I just want to reiterate once again, I believe it's wrong to remove the education subcommittee.
Any further discussion? Let's move to a roll call vote.
Member Beardmore?
Beardmore, yes.
Member Gustafson?
Gustafson, no.
Member Dubois?
Dubois, yes.
Member Brennan?
Brennan, yes.
Sorry?
She said yes.
She said yes, thank you. Member Kirschenbaum?
Kirschenbaum, yes.
Member Kaminsky?
Kaminsky, no.
Member Otmar?
Otmar, yes.
Member Lorway?
Lorway abstains.
Member Salmon Garrett?
Salmon Garrett, yes.
Member Wallace?
Wallace, yes.
Member Winters?
Winters, no.
Member Poole?
Poole, yes.
Member Lavoie?
Lavoie, no.
Member Lorway? Oh, I'm sorry, you've already abstained. Member Woodland?
Woodland, yes.
The chair abstains and the motion passes. I would accept a motion to amend policy 3900, policy related to education program evaluation, second reading, waiving the reading.
So moved.
Second.
Linda and Jana. Any discussion? Seeing none, we can move right to a roll call vote.
Member Woodland?
Woodland, yes.
Member Winters?
Winters, yes.
Member Wallace?
Wallace, yes.
Member Otmar?
Otmar, yes.
Member Poole?
Poole, yes.
Member Lavoie?
Lavoie, yes.
Member Lorway?
Lorway, yes.
Member Kaminsky?
Kaminsky, yes.
Member Kirschenbaum?
Kirschenbaum, yes.
Member Gustafson?
Gustafson, yes.
Member Beardmore?
Beardmore, yes.
Member Dubois?
Dubois, yes.
Member Brennan?
Brennan, yes.
Vice Chair Salmon Garrett?
Salmon Garrett, yes.
Chair Runstrom?
The chair abstains and the motion passes. I would accept a motion to affirm policy 3360, policy related to education, independent learning, second reading, waiving the reading.
So moved.
Second.
Linda and Shannon. We can move to a roll call vote. Actually, any discussion first before we go to a roll call vote? Seeing none, we can move to the roll call.
Member Kaminsky?
Kaminsky, yes.
Member Otmar?
Otmar, yes.
Member Lavoy?
Lavoy, yes.
Member Beardmore?
Beardmore, yes.
Member Woodland?
Woodland, yes.
Member Wallace?
Wallace, yes.
Member Poole?
Poole, yes.
Member Winters?
Winters, yes.
Member Kirschenbaum?
Kirschenbaum, yes.
Member Gustafson?
Gustafson, yes.
Member Brennan?
Brennan, yes.
Member Dubois?
Dubois, yes.
Member Lorway?
Lorway, yes.
Vice Chair Salmon Garrett?
Salmon Garrett, yes.
And Chair Renstrom?
Chair abstains and the motion passes. Okay, I would accept a motion to amend policy 1340, policy related to school committee operations, school district council, second reading, waiving the reading.
So moved.
Second.
Linda and Lauren. Any discussion? Seeing none, we can move to a roll call vote.
Member Winters?
Winters, yes.
Member Lavoy?
Lavoy, yes.
Member Kaminsky?
Kaminsky, no.
Member Kirschenbaum?
Kirschenbaum, yes.
Member Gustafson?
Gustafson, yes.
Member Poole?
Poole, yes.
Member Otmar?
Otmar, yes.
Member Lorway?
Point of information, this is the independent learning policy.
No, this we're on school district council. Dana?
Lorway abstain.
Member Woodland?
Woodland, yes.
Member Dubois?
Dubois, yes.
Member Brennan?
Brennan, yes.
Member Beardmore?
Beardmore, yes.
Member Wallace?
Wallace, yes.
Vice Chair Salmon Garrett?
Salmon Garrett, yes.
Chair Renstrom?
Chair abstains and the motion passes. I would accept a motion to amend policy 1520, policy related to school committee operations, policy development, second reading, waiving the reading.
So moved.
Second.
Linda and Shannon? Any discussion? Seeing none, we'll move to a roll call vote.
Member Beardmore?
Beardmore, yes.
Member Wallace?
Wallace, yes.
Member Kirschenbaum?
Kirschenbaum, yes.
Member Gustafson?
Gustafson, yes.
Member Winters?
Winters, yes.
Member Brennan?
Brennan, yes.
Vice Chair Salmon Garrett?
Salmon Garrett, yes.
Member Otmar?
Otmar, yes.
Member Lorway?
Lorway, yes.
Member Woodland?
Woodland, yes.
Member Lavoy?
Lavoy, yes.
Member Kaminsky?
Kaminsky abstain.
Member Poole?
Poole, yes.
Member Dubois?
Dubois, yes.
Chair Renstrom?
The chair abstains and the motion passes. All right, I would accept a motion to amend policy 6619, policy related to pupil services, life-threatening allergies, first reading.
So moved. So moved. Oh, second.
So moved.
All right. Malia and Linda in some order.
Okay.
So would someone like to speak to the motion?
Yes.
So
I would.
Before you do, so this motion was made at request of a member not to waive the reading. So a member would like to read the policy.
The entire policy. Okay. I mean, I think that's highly unusual, but
it's
sure.
Very unusual, but the member is offered to read the policy. They wanted it read. And so you could speak to it after it's read, but
I mean,
actually, if you would like to read it, go ahead.
I don't know what makes the most sense. I was prepared to speak to it paragraph by paragraph, so now I may have to read it twice. I mean, I can read it or share the reading of it. It's quite lengthy.
It was Member Woodland who requested.
Okay, do you want to read it?
Yeah.
You can read it. Go ahead, and then I can speak to it. That's fine. Thank you.
So the name of the policy is life-threatening allergies. The Wachusett Regional School District is committed to providing a safe and healthy school environment for all students that is inclusive of school-wide practices that will minimize the risk of exposure to allergens that pose a threat to students while participating in all elements of the school day. School-wide practices, along with identified accommodations as deemed necessary by school personnel in consultation with parents and guardians and/or the students' medical providers, will ensure that all students are provided with an equal opportunity to participate in all school programs and activities. The successful management of this policy will require a partnership among the parents, guardians, the student, and the school personnel involved with the education, extracurricular activities, and the transportation of the student. The district shall follow 105 CMR 210.000 regarding administration of epinephrine in public schools, including education, training, and timetables. The district will update and implement the allergy awareness protocol that will include, but is not limited to, education of the school community about life-threatening allergies, training for all staff, emergency plans, and procedures. The major goals of this protocol are to reduce the risk of exposure to allergens during the school day that could trigger life-threatening responses and to optimize emergency responses in the event that life-threatening reactions occur. This protocol will be reviewed annually. The school nurse, in conjunction with the parent and guardian and the medical provider, will provide with the provide either the allergy action plan and or the individual health care plan for every student with a life-threatening allergy. The allergy action plan and or individual health care plan will be updated annually. Students will also be referred for an evaluation of eligibility under Section 504 of the Rehabilitation Act. The superintendent will ensure that the district physician provides each school health office with the medical orders necessary to maintain a supply of all medications, including epinephrine, as well as the ability to administer the epinephrine as necessary. The superintendent will also will ensure that the school epinephrine controlled substance registration is renewed annually. To ensure the safety and well-being of students and other individuals with food-based allergies, parents and guardians may not send outside food, candy, or drink to share at school. Both teachers and parents and guardians are encouraged to recognize and celebrate students by methods that do not involve food. Any projects or classroom activities should also avoid the use of food items. Extra precautions will be taken if traditional school-based celebrations, i.e. the eighth grade cookout, dances, etc., have been permitted by the superintendent. All student handbook policies and statements pertaining to the support of a safe and healthy school environment should make reference to the safety and well-being of those students with food and life-threatening allergies.
Okay. Malia, would you like to speak to the policy?
I would. And what I'm going to do, just I didn't have time to do this thoroughly at our last meeting. I'm going to go through each paragraph and just address what has been changed or kept and why. To make sure that everything is covered, and I'm sure others will have thoughts based on our last discussion. The first paragraph of the original policy had no changes. It was kept intact as written originally. Second paragraph, we added text to clarify that 105 CMR 210 regarding the administration of epinephrine in schools will be followed. This includes education, training, and timetables. Also, we stated that the allergy protocols will be followed as well. Also, to clarify, 105 CMR 210, which is linked at the bottom of the document, I'm going to quote from that. It states that the training at minimum shall include procedures for risk reduction, recognition of the symptoms of severe allergic reaction, the importance of following the medical administrative plan, proper use of the auto injector, and requirements for proper storage and security, notification of appropriate persons following administration and record keeping. All of that is from the state CMR law, so we did not we didn't include that word for word in the policy, but we did state we would be following that law. And that is directly quoted from CMR 210. Also, the goal of the detailed protocols, which are referenced, is, as mentioned, to reduce risk of exposure to allergens during the school day and optimize emergency response in the event that a life-threatening reaction occurs. That's repeated in this as well as in the protocols. The protocols also lay out clear and detailed responses in terms of notifications and actions expected to reduce the risk of exposure to life-threatening allergens in school activities. This is more detailed than what was included in the original policy. And also, the protocols at the end also include the links to the U.S. federal government and DESE guidelines for handling life-threatening allergy in schools. They are referenced. They are informing the creation of the policies, of the protocols and the policy directly here, which we are considering references those protocols and says they shall be followed. So therefore, if the law changes, our procedures noted in the protocols would be kept up to date by saying we're following it, as well as our policy would be kept up to date even as the law changes, without us having to reread this every time a law changes. The school committee also is responsible for policy. We are not directly responsible for writing the detailed protocols and taking things from the DESE slides and trainings that are provided to our administrators. So we trust that they will follow those, and we have indicated that we expect that to be followed according to law. The third paragraph we basically altered some of the language to eliminate redundancy in the original document, given the second paragraph that we had added. We also note that the nurse and parent and guardian will meet to discuss the allergy action plan and or individual health care plan for every student with life-threatening allergies, every student, and it will be updated annually as required by law. Every student will have a discussion with school staff and will go through the protocols and through what the needs are for those students. Also, which we thought was especially important, is that it also specifically states in paragraph 3, which we added, that students will be referred for evaluation of 504 eligibility. If you have a life-threatening allergy, you will be referred automatically for that evaluation process. The previous one said they may, and it also allows for the possibility that when those federal eligibility standards and processes change, they will automatically be followed because of the changes we've made to this policy. And they are expected to change this fall. And we've been advised by our attorney they are likely changing shortly. But this will ensure that those that you are referred for an evaluation if you have a life-threatening allergy, and that whatever the current federal law is will be followed. Paragraph 4 of the original policy we deleted because it was redundant with paragraphs 2 and 3, which we had added. Paragraph 5, we deleted the first portion because it is included explicitly in 105 CMR 210 regarding specific trainings and staff on it being trained on administration of EpiPens, et cetera, as I quoted earlier. The portion that we kept intact is regarding, we kept intact a portion about the superintendent ensuring that the physician provides each health office with medical orders necessary. And we added a sentence which also makes sure we're adhering to another piece of the law, which requires the superintendent to also ensure that the epinephrine controlled substances registration is renewed and updated annually. So we made sure that was also included. In paragraph 6, we deleted because those are, again, covered in the protocols. The information is in the protocols and the training required under 105 CMR 210. Paragraph 7, we basically didn't take anything of substance out. We just altered some of the wording to make it flow a little bit better. And we did maintain the statement that for school-wide traditional events like the cookout, et cetera, the superintendent would be consulted and extra precautions would be taken. Also, that is a situation where, again, the protocols and the notifications would all be followed as stated. And then at the end, also there is a statement that we took out about the bullying statement in particular, because there is a statement that references handbooks and that all information in the handbooks would apply to these students, particularly regarding bullying. And the bullying prevention and intervention plan is included in those handbooks. And so we thought referring to the handbooks, it would be redundant to keep the specific bullying content in there because it is covered in other places. So we were very careful that was not taken out as a point of discussion. It was something that we felt was already covered in other places. There are, and that reference to the handbooks is maintained from the original.
Also, you'll see there's some references added that were not in the original plan. We added legal references, we added the CMR 210, we added the section 504 of the Rehabilitation Act, which again will take, and these are linked on the live document, so parents and families and any member of our community can go directly to that document. That's something we felt was incredibly important to make sure they have all the information they need in one place. We also referenced MGL and USDA certifications. Also, when you go into the protocol document, that also has specific links at the end of it to the full guidelines for the U.S. government, the USGA, the federal government level allergy guidelines, and the DESE guidelines regarding life-threatening allergies in schools. And so, again, that is baked into our policy and protocols that we already are covering. We did look at a number of other policies when we looked at this, and a majority of them took this approach where they had a shorter policy and then had protocols attached and federal guidelines attached. And so we were very cautious to make sure that we did that, and we provided families links to every piece of information that is indicated in this. So I will ask your support in supporting this. I believe that we did not take out anything essential that was in this. I believe that we made sure anything that we deleted from the original policy was included in some other place in our documents and our requirements and expectations that we would be following them to protect our students. So with that, I'll entertain questions, and obviously there's more discussion.
Further discussion.
We've heard a lot about this. I think one of the things I remember hearing from quite a few people was the concern about the allergy awareness protocol, and that with policies, we have to change those publicly and have a discussion about them, but that there was some fear that the allergy awareness protocol might be changed because it's not a policy, and that was where a lot of the information that there was concern coming out of the policy. So was there any discussion of, adding something about the allergy awareness protocol, if any changes to that being communicated either publicly or to students with health plans? And
I cannot, of course, speak for the whole committee, but I can say that this document does indicate that that protocol would be reviewed at least annually. Also, there are many protocols in our district, and protocols for all kinds of things. And our school committee, because of how our roles are created, we can offer insights and thoughts, and many of them are brought to us for discussion or information, but we don't approve every word of every protocol in the district. And so I will say that the things that I have heard concerns about, the very specific things that have been taken out of this policy from the original version, are all things that we made sure were included or referenced in this, and they are included in our policy in the protocols. The protocols are actually more extensive in their level of detail than what is in this original document. But also, any of the things that are specifically mentioned are things that are included in most of them, actually, the whole fourth paragraph, included in state training guidelines, which I quoted, and I also we've seen the slides. As a committee, we did go through and see the slides that were presented last year about the protocols, and they were presented to the whole school committee earlier in the year in the fall. And so I think I don't want to speak for everyone, but I think the subcommittee that looked at this was confident that we were very cautious that those things were not being eliminated, that they were covered in state law. And so we weren't just taking them out or omitting them.
Do you have a follow-up? Sure.
And I do understand that, because if the law changes and we have that wording in our law, then our policy is no longer.
But we did make sure also that they were, as I quoted, they are in this CMR 105 CMR 210,
yeah.
Specifically the language that's in
that we eliminated from this is included in the law, which we referenced specifically.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and that's what I'm supporting.
Yes.
That if that law changes, we just have the link
correct.
To the law. I still have concern about the allergy awareness protocol and any changes. I understand we have a lot of protocols in this district, but this is a life or death situation for kids, and you know, it's why parents are so passionate about it. I don't have a child with an allergy, but there are many children in my one of my kids' grades with allergies. So I still remain concerned about the fact that this allergy awareness protocol could be changed, and you know, that wouldn't necessarily be information that the public would know or those concerned parents would know. That's my concern.
So
got Linda.
I think that I can answer that from our discussions from the subcommittee, our many, many meetings about this. So what we talked about was going through the protocol that is reviewed annually, the protocol itself. Every single year, the families will have to review their individual plans for their child with the school nurse and their medical providers, and go over and make sure that everything is agreed upon. And that has to be an agreement between all parties. So that would be the time when protocols that are changing, they would be updated as part of that process for that plan. That was how it was explained when we were discussing about this and how to make sure that we have an actionable policy. As long as we have an actual policy that can be followed, and then the protocols would be updated and the families would be communicated with, and this other adults who are associated with the care of the child, everybody would have that communication in as reasonable as you can expect for something that's so important.
Okay. Shannon,
she,
and then Matt.
She said, you can skip me. She said mostly what I was going to say.
Okay. Matt.
So can you repeat the first part of the paragraph of the policy that has the word partnership and who's included in that partnership? I just want to make sure I heard it appropriately.
The first paragraph?
Should be.
The very first paragraph, we did not change anything from the original policy.
The first thing that was read of partnership.
But it says...
Last sentence.
The very last sentence says the successful management of this policy will require a partnership among the parents, guardians, the student, and school personnel involved with the education, extracurricular activities, and transportation of the student.
So that partnership typically is a legal term, and that's usually a legal agreement between two or more parties. And it sounds like we're putting legal requirement into a policy. So I just want to make sure that we're aware of what that term partnership means, that a legal document would be generated and all parties would sign off on that. That is the legal definition of partnership. So I just want to make sure we're clear of that and we have a procedure in place to make sure it supports that part of the policy.
Can I speak to that?
Why? Sorry.
No, go ahead. No, keep going.
Sorry. Linda, sorry.
I was out of turn.
Yeah. I was only going to that's fine.
Sorry.
I'm sorry. I thought you were asking.
No, I'm making a point about partnership.
Okay, go for it then.
That's a concern that I have of that. And that bleeds into the second concern, which is since the inception of this policy, which first appeared on a school committee agenda, and I'll remind the public and the body, it was a motion to delete the policy. That's how it first appeared. And then it was referred to a subcommittee. Since then, we've continued to hear from meeting after meeting after meeting from the public that is not in support of this. I don't know if I've heard from one member of the public that has said, I support this policy. Having said that, in good faith, part of our development of policy is to say, before we vote on anything, we should consider information from all parties. We heard from members of the public even tonight, letters of statement. It would be, I think, in our best interest to perhaps make a motion to refer this to the policy subcommittee and allow the public to see this policy, how it relates to protocol, and come back to the body
where we have that support from the public. I don't think that moving a motion like this forward in this case is really in the best interest of this body, where we've seen challenges with communication with the public. So I'm prepared to make a motion to refer this policy back to the policy subcommittee for further review and for public comment.
I've heard a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by George. We're now speaking to the motion. I know, Linda, you were next on my list, so if you'd like to speak to the motion, go ahead.
So we've had a lot of public input at the meetings of our subcommittee, and one of the parents that was there has since said that she fully supports this amended version with her child with a life-threatening allergy, that this version of the policy checks all of the marks that she was looking for, and she's in full support, and that's why we're not hearing from her anymore, because it looks good. There are multiple parents who we did hear from at first, and now that we have our the draft that we're putting forward, they haven't kept coming because they've read it and they can see that it fulfills their needs. So there is no need, after all of the research, all of the public hearings that we've had for policies, and I'd like to ask how many of our policies receive public hearings whatsoever in subcommittees. This one did. And has had multiple parents come in to weigh in multiple times. We have done the public aspect of this. We have listened to the feedback. We had deep concerns. The subcommittee had deep concerns about the questions of removing the 504 provision. We had deep concerns about removing the policy completely. And that is why we're not bringing forward a motion to delete. We brought forward an amended policy where we took a harder look at the actual language, the actual requirements, the actual process of how a student who is identified with a life-threatening allergy and what they go through from that notice to being in school safely. And what happens if things go wrong. This has been researched, written over, considered. We have made so many additions to strengthen protections for our children. We have made so many choices to make sure, before the 504 eligibility was tied to if they have an EpiPen, and that was wrong. It was flat out wrong, and it leaves a lot of kids in falling through the cracks, and we tightened that up. We made sure that the food for celebrations had the same prohibition and made that language stronger to make sure it was crystal clear. There is nothing to go back to. That's all.
Okay. Further discussion on the motion? Aaliyah.
Can I speak to the current motion?
Yes.
Yes. Member Woodland stated most of what I would state. However, I will also echo that through this process, I did hear from multiple former school committee members and multiple parents, as we said at our meeting. Even a few current and past school committee members attended our meetings and voiced their opinion. Since we have had a draft for them to see, most of those people have either contacted me directly and said, we're fine, you've satisfied my questions, or I'm just informing, or I have not heard from them. I have two parents that I have continuously heard from, I'll be perfectly honest. I don't mind. Everyone has a right to express their opinion, but we have over 800 students with life-threatening allergies, and I think we have been very clear when we're speaking about this. I know I personally have posted it on my page multiple times and gotten feedback from parents saying thank you for keeping us updated. And so I feel like there are over 800 families with life-threatening allergies in this district. And I think if all of them were opposed to this, then we would be hearing from them. And we are not. We are hearing from less than five at this point. And I'm not saying there are not others that disagree with them, but we have not received letters from them. We have had, since October, we have been offering opportunities to provide input on this. How many months is that? That's like 7 months. Since October, when this was first brought to us. And I think we have done our due diligence. We have read and researched programs from other schools that people have sent us, policies from other schools, I may have miscounted in my speaking. I'm sure Member LaVoy will correct me, but we have been talking about this a very long time, and I do think that we have provided opportunity for people.
Sorry.
Through the chair, I would ask that no member address another member like that, saying Member LaVoy will challenge that. I'd appreciate that. Thank you.
Point taken.
I apologize. I did not mean it in detriment. I meant it as you're going to correct my math, which is fine because I'm speaking. But I do think Member Winland did an excellent job of summing it up, and I think we have had opportunities for feedback for months.
Okay.
And this is what we have brought forth. I think we've been very diligent, and I think sending it to another subcommittee will just delay putting in place some of the changes that actually are needed in this policy.
Okay. Member LaVoy, you had your hand up again.
Yeah, there are a few statements that were made, and I just want to clarify for a point of information. Have we, through the chair or this body, heard of from anyone in the public with a statement saying that they're in support of this policy? Have we received a written letter, anything, a statement from anyone in public session in this body?
I heard Member Gustafson say that she had. I don't recall a letter written that to me specifically.
I just want to clarify a few other points that were made. One, personal social media pages are not mechanisms to communicate to the public. As a member of this body, none of us should ever speak on behalf of the body and then take non-response as a mechanism to communicate to the public. So I'd appreciate through the chair that behavior is ceased immediately. The other piece that I would like to call out is it's been acknowledged that this policy has been kicked around since October. We've kicked the can down the road without really hearing from the public. And over time, people will silence. That's what typically happens. People forget about things, and I fear as if that's the move that we've made, because I don't recall one person coming to this meeting and speaking in support of this. I don't recall receiving one email. I do recall members of the body saying, anecdotally, I've heard from people, or I haven't. That's their impression of non-communication. But again, I'm going to go back to my point of we should consider all information, and we're not considering the public.
Any further discussion on the motion to refer to subcommittee?
I say one more thing.
No.
You have one more time to
speak. I will be done after this. I will state that we also had publicly posted 9 meetings about this at various times, day and evening. They were publicly posted, not on personal pages. They were on the official school committee postings. And I do think I wasn't going to mention that because I'm trying to focus on the content of the policy and the changes that we did make. But since it is brought up, I will mention that. But again, I will urge people to not delay this further because there are some significant changes that have been made, and they are strengthening the ability to comply with the laws and to lay out specific protocols and procedures for students and make sure that we can support our students consistently across all of our schools.
Okay, I think we've covered discussion on whether to refer to subcommittee unless somebody has something brand new that we haven't discussed. So I think we're ready to vote on the motion to refer this policy back to subcommittee.
Member Kirschenbaum?
Abstain.
Member Gustafson?
No.
Member Beardmore?
Beardmore, no.
Member Dubois,
no.
Vice Chair Salmon-Garrett?
Salmon-Garrett, no.
Member Wallace?
Wallace, no.
Member Brennan?
Brennan, no.
Member Lorway?
Lorway, no.
Member Poole?
Poole, no.
Member Otmar?
Otmar, no.
Member Kaminsky?
Kaminsky abstained.
Member Winters?
Winters abstained.
Member Woodland?
Woodland, no.
Member LaVoy?
LaVoy, yes.
Chair Runstrom?
The chair abstains. The motion fails. So we have to go back to the original motion to amend the policy. Is there any further discussion on the motion to amend the policy? I see a hand, but I don't know who it is. So go ahead. Carl, I think it's Carl.
This is Rob. I would move to amend the policy so that at the end of the second paragraph, this gets to Member Salmon Garrett's comment, that it will say this protocol will be reviewed annually with all changes reported to the full committee or reported to the school committee.
Okay.
Point of clarification, reviewed by whom? By what?
Can you restate your amendment, please, Carl, and we'll try and get it.
District reviews it.
So the last line currently it says this protocol will be reviewed annually.
Yep.
The amendment would have that last sentence to say that this protocol will be reviewed annually and changes reported to the school committee.
Okay.
Second.
Seconded by Lauren, and I think it's pretty clear.
I'm sorry,
me. Lauren. George, you made a point of information. Was that answered?
Yes.
Okay. So, been moved and seconded. So, any discussion on this amendment to add the words and changes reported to the school committee? Linda.
I don't believe it's within our purview. Since it's the protocol, I would prefer it to say something like reviewed annually and communicated to the, you know, posted to the district website, distributed to through to the district, something along those lines, because it's.
Yeah, no, I hear what you're saying, but it already says reviewed by the school committee, so part of that review to me seems.
It doesn't say reviewed by the school committee.
This protocol would be reviewed.
Reviewed the by the district. The protocol itself would be reviewed by the district. So that would be what the nurses have to go through and what our nurse leader would have to go through for training for all of the teachers and other professionals and other adults interacting in the schools.
Okay.
So I understand the intent. I think the intent is good.
I hear your point. I don't think it's so egregious that I would rule that it's not a valid amendment, so we'll leave it to the body to decide. Lauren.
Yeah, I think I wasn't sure about the word school committee in there, but I think then that does make it a public document, and it is noted that there have been changes and there will be a link in a public document. I think that's where I kind of reframed my thinking, because when it comes to us, it becomes public information. So I think that might be the easiest way for that to happen. I'm not sure.
Any further discussion about this amendment, Jana?
Right, so the amendment is just stating that it will be presented to school committee. It doesn't say that we're voting on the protocol. Mm-hmm. We're changing them in any way. It's just that we're getting
reported.
So I feel like I could be okay with that because we're not having reviewer change
over. Okay, Malia?
So the second sentence of that paragraph says the district will update and implement the allergy awareness protocols. I think adding the word school committee to the last sentence contradicts and confuses that. I also do think I go back to the purview question, and I'm concerned that we don't have, I think if it says the protocol will be reviewed annually and shared at a school committee meeting or with the school committee, implies that the school committee is doing the reviewing, which contradicts the second sentence and our purview by law. I think it may be more useful to say, you could say reviewed and presented to the school committee annually, or reviewed and posted on our website annually. I'm fine with an amendment to say, can I make amendment?
Yes.
To the amendment?
An amendment.
To say this protocol will be reviewed and presented to the school committee annually. That way, I think it is clear that the school committee is not the one doing the actual reviewing.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Okay. So we've now amended the amendment so now the sentence reads, this protocol will be reviewed and presented to the school committee annually, period. Any discussion about this amendment? To the amendment.
Should say reviewed annually and presented to the school committee.
I will accept that. That's a wording thing.
Okay, can you read it to me so that we know it?
The protocol will be reviewed annually and presented to the school committee.
I don't know.
Does that make sense?
So the amendment now, so I'm just going to read, correct me if I'm wrong, changing the last sentence to say this protocol will be reviewed annually and presented to the school committee.
Does that make sense?
What
was the first version?
All right. I had a question from Shannon, and then we'll go back to Paul.
I thought that was what the First Amendment was. So can you please read the
Yes, my First Amendment was to
no,
say.
No, Carl's.
No.
Carl's.
Oh,
I'm so sorry. Carl's amendment is to say this protocol will be reviewed annually and changes reported to the school committee.
So just the changes part was.
Now the new one, we're talking about changing it to this protocol will be reviewed annually and presented to the school committee. Yes?
Can I comment on the new motion?
Yes, you may.
Okay. So I think that the changes part is important because we don't need the whole thing reviewed, presented to us every single time, every year. I think just the changes so that we can know it. And I think that Carl's statement is pretty close to what Leah is saying now.
That is correct. I will withdraw my motion. Yeah. Can I do that? Yes.
Is there an objection to withdrawing the motion for Leah's amendment? Without objection, you may withdraw.
Thank you, I will, because I forgot about the word changes. Thank you.
Okay, so we're now back to Carl's. We're now discussing Carl's amendment to change the sentence to say this protocol will be reviewed annually and changes reported to the school committee. Any further discussion about this amendment? All right, we are ready to vote on Carl's amendment.
Member Salmon-Garrett?
Salmon-Garrett, yes.
Member Gustafson?
Gustafson, yes.
Member Lorway?
Lorway, yes.
Member Woodlands?
Woodland, no.
Member Dubois?
Dubois, yes.
Member Kirschenbaum?
Kirschenbaum, yes.
Member Otmar?
Otmar, yes.
Member Brennan?
Brennan, yes.
Member Poole?
Poole, yes.
Member Winters?
Winters abstain.
Member Wallace?
Wallace, yes.
Member Kaminsky?
Kaminsky abstain.
Member Lavoie?
Lavoie, no.
Member Beardmore?
Beardmore, yes.
Chair Runstrom?
Chair abstains and the motion passes. All right, we are back to voting, I believe, on the policy as a whole. Any further comments on the policy as a whole with the amendment that we just added to it? Seeing none, we are ready to vote on amending the policy as amended. All right.
Poole?
Poole, yes.
Member Gustafson?
Gustafson, yes.
Member Wallace?
Wallace, yes.
Member Woodland?
Woodland, yes.
Member Kaminsky?
Kaminsky, no.
Member Beardmore?
Beardmore, yes.
Member Dubois?
Dubois, yes.
Member Salmon-Garrett?
Salmon-Garrett, yes.
Member Lavoie?
Lavoie, no.
Member Winters?
Winters, no.
Member Kirschenbaum?
Kirschenbaum, abstain.
Member Brennan?
Brennan, yes.
Member Otmar?
Otmar, yes.
Member Lorway?
Lorway, yes.
Chair Runstrom?
The chair abstains and the motion passes. Okay. Last motion under committee business is a motion from Member Kaminsky. Do you want to make the motion or do you want me to read it?
Yes, sir. So the motion is as follows. The committee charges the policy subcommittee with developing a policy that will safeguard students' choice in selecting academic course sequences.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
I think Matt seconded it. Any discussion?
If I may speak to the...
Yep, absolutely.
Yeah. Dr. Riley has noted today, there are certain sequences of courses, for example, in languages, where it is really beneficial for a student to be sure that he or she can, you know, once they start this sequence, they can proceed through all the steps. For example, exemplified by the French class, I suppose you cannot take anything beyond the third level. You start having issues with the graduation requirements for the high school, with the college admission requirements, certain colleges. Furthermore, this hurts the, this actually violates the policy 1030 in the equity part because the students are going to experience unequal hardship in continuing their high school studies should further classes in the sequence be terminated. yes, not every sequence would necessarily fall under this category, so perhaps, well, there should be policy developed by the policy subcommittee. Perhaps the administration would produce a list of these sequences that would be would fall under this policy and will again report to the school committee, but this would definitely help the district avoid all, you know, all the drama, all these emergency modes that were involved, for example, in restoring the French classes that we've seen today.
Okay. Any further discussion? Member Kirschenbaum.
I would like to amend the policy. I'd like to strike developing a policy to say review policies to ensure that there are safeguards in place in selecting academic course sequences.
Can you say that again? Because I'm going to write it down.
Review policies to ensure that there are safeguards in place in selecting academic course sequences.
Okay, second. Is there a second?
Second.
So just to speak to that, this is a new subcommittee, the policy subcommittee, and I would offer that I would challenge a motion that already draws the conclusion that it's developing a policy that will solve a problem. And so charging the subcommittee to review policies to ensure a certain goal, I think is better. That way, we can look at all the policies that currently exist. We have 25 operating policies in the 1000 series. We have 34 education policies in the 3000 series. We have 46 pupil services policies in the 6000 series. I think that we have a number of policies that may already accomplish that task. We also have an administration that admits that that is their goal, to safeguard those. So I would argue that we don't need to mandate a conclusion that we haven't actually evaluated. I don't think we should mandate a policy we haven't really accurately determined that there's a problem to solve, and we haven't reviewed all the policies that currently exist. We don't want to hamstring our administration into instituting practices that may or may not be in the best interest of our district.
Okay. So, go ahead, Matt.
I just have a concern on the way that the amendment's written. I agree with the basis behind it, that it's difficult to say, hey, let's develop this. But my fear is now, with the amendment, we're now reviewing every policy versus, and maybe the intent, and I don't know if it is, to review every policy or to review whether or not sequencing as it relates to graduation requirements is covered. And if it's not, perhaps the report back is a modification of a policy or something of that. And if that's the intent, I could see that supporting it, but I don't want to get drowned in the weeds of reviewing 88 policies and then figuring out what we're doing with this one versus that one, because I don't think that's the intent of our organization, of this body,
okay,
of the policy subcommittee.
Lauren?
I do get the point of that, but we just reaffirmed or something the independent learning policy, and that's one that in this case would maybe be something that would a student might have to do if they were like the only student that was trying to get into a class. So I see your point, but I just feel like the by title, the policies will become evident that should be really reviewed. But I understand that concern.
I'm just as one member, I would not interpret review policies to mean you have to review all policies, like financial policies. Obviously, there's a lot of stuff that wouldn't apply. So I don't think that would be the assumption.
Member Kirschenbaum is the chair of that policy subcommittee, so I just wanted to understand the intent. So if you could just address.
Can I speak to that? I mean, like, we already have, for example, we already have policy, you know, 3311 on online education policy. We have 3341 on curriculum adoption. We have 3360 on independent learning. We have 3311.4 on enrichment. I feel like there are already many policies, and adding more policies, we're drawing a conclusion with this motion that may or may not solve the problem and may just add more bureaucracy to our already piled on policies. So I just don't want to you know, make a motion that just willy-nilly creates a policy just for the sake of creating more policies.
Malia.
So my question, I agree with the sentiment behind the motion or the amendment. However, I do also wonder, my first question was, what does their handbook say? Because I know there is a very detailed guide to curriculum instruction that lays out what you can select and when and the sequence of courses. And I think, I mean, I haven't read it recently, the recent version, but I would like to know what something like that says as well, because again, I go back to our purview as policy versus implementation. And does this go beyond our scope as a school committee to spell out something about, for example, French and language classes, when there may be other general language in their general course selection process that we're not familiar with? I don't know the answer to that, but that is my, I agree with the sentiment behind it, but my general concern with this is that we don't, this, our policies are not the only guiding document for course selections at the high school. Mm-hmm. And I would like to clarify that first. I mean, personally, I would prefer to see, I don't know if this would follow the subcommittee. I would prefer to see some sort of perhaps report on the process or some more information on the process that students have now for selecting courses and what guides that. And I know that's very complicated. I don't know what the answer is.
Is this really related to the amendment?
It is related to the amendment because it is in my mind because
Hold on. Yes. I get to answer that.
I'm sorry.
Not you. I'm going to allow the response because I think she's speaking against the amendment. So, but you are on sort of shaky grounds. You're going off.
I'm sorry. I apologize for that. I will revise. I just say, as I said, I agree with the sentiment, but my concern is that even the amendment is limiting because there are other factors that we don't know yet. And I feel like I need more information in order to be involved in this kind of decision.
Linda.
So my only question and hesitation here, we have a new subcommittee that's charged with looking at policy. We also have a strategic plan, and before we've had our planning meeting where we talk about district goals, we're charging a new subcommittee with a one-off motion. I would prefer to wait on this until we talk about our district goals, see how we're aligned with the overall goals that have been laid out that we approved last January, and look at what else, because we don't know if this is really top precedence yet. It might be.
So I'm just gonna stop you because we're talking about an amendment to the amendment. So you're talking about the actual motion and pedantic, but we have to.
I understand that. I mean, I feel the same applies to the amendment. That the review, to charge the policy subcommittee to review policies to safeguard, that will ensure, et cetera.
Okay.
That, I'm arguing that even that review is problematic before we know what our goal is for the year. We keep on having these kind of popcorn events coming up, and I feel like we need to really focus. We have a small administration here. Okay. Policy turns into work for them.
I think,
and
okay.
We want to be strategic.
Yep, I get it. I think we get the point. Any more discussion about the amendment from Member Kirschenbaum? Seeing none, we're ready to vote on the amendment from Member Kirschenbaum. And just to reiterate what we're voting on, I think it's important. The committee charges the policy subcommittee with reviewing policies to ensure that there are safeguards in place to safeguarding academic course sequences. Did I get that right?
In selecting academic course sequences. That part was the same language. It was It was more just changing development policy to review policies.
I just have a question.
Yes.
So we voted on an organization and we voted on a policy subcommittee. And one of the duties is review policies to ensure they meet the needs of all students. Is this already covered in the duty of the policy subcommittee?
Well, we're talking about
the amendment.
Yes, we're talking about the amendment.
That's
and I think we are talking about sending it to the subcommittee. So I'm not
I'm just wondering if the amendment is already covered in the duty. Do we have to have a motion? Because the duty of the subcommittee is review policies to ensure they meet the needs of all students.
But we're asking the subcommittee to work on something specific, so I think it is valid.
Can I just clarify?
Sure.
I think that I see this as a potential new policy as opposed to an existing policy. And it's muddy because we would be reviewing existing policies, right, which I think ought to have a charge, and also instituting a new policy should also have a charge. So I think that this is either way, it should come from this body. Any direction that the policy committee has should be coming from this body or through it from administration.
Okay. So
can I amend the amendment?
You can amend an amendment once. Yes, you may.
So I would amend it to refer this to the policy subcommittee to review policies to ensure they meet the needs of all students and to make recommendations for policy revisions, additions, or deletions to the full body.
Okay, can you read it one more time just sure. So everyone knows what we're talking about?
Points two and three from the directly identified.
I've got too many words on my thing now.
It's points two and three from the duties because the other piece we can't do yet.
So the committee charges the policy subcommittee with reviewing policies to ensure they meet the needs of all students and make recommendations for policy revisions, additions, or deletions to the committee?
Correct.
Period?
Period.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay, made and seconded. Is there any discussion about this amendment?
Quick discussion.
Yep.
There are four duties.
Point of order is that the second is not Lauren. That came from online.
Oh, sorry, I think it was Jamie who seconded it. Jamie, was that you?
That was me, Jamie.
Okay.
So just a quick point.
Yep.
There are four duties under the policy subcommittee, and the first and the fourth one can not yet happen with other subcommittees not meeting yet. So I just took the second and third to give that liberty that if this is part of that discussion, it allows for the policy subcommittee to get underway and start doing business while we wait for further direction from the full body.
Okay. Member Lorway.
My only offering here is that I'm not prepared to charge a subcommittee of this committee with something that I think they are going to take responsibility for as it's required. I think they're going to do it without us offering a charge to them.
Okay. Are we ready to vote on the amendment to the amendment? We're gonna have to unpack this now. All right, we're voting on Matt's language, the amendment to the amendment.
I have a question.
Yes.
Wouldn't it be contrary to the newly adopted policy on whatever, making policies?
I didn't understand the question, so just restate it, please.
Policy development.
Yes.
Because I understand that policy development must start in the full committee. And therefore, it would not be the charge of the subcommittee to decide, you know, where to really start developing those policies.
I don't think so, and here's why. I think we're charging the subcommittee to look at the existing policies and develop a new policy if needed and on a specific subject, and I think that's okay. That is my interpretation.
Oh, but the specific subject is not noted in this amended motion.
But he said.
I think you're right. So, yeah. Yep. So Matt's motion has taken out the...
It's to report back to the full body those...
But we took out the part about safeguarding students' choice and selecting course sequences. So we haven't actually, we've just charged them with doing their duties.
I didn't take that out, I amended the.
That's what I was wondering.
Okay.
Yeah,
I don't think we have your amendment correct.
Okay.
So your amendment, I'm gonna try it again.
It's not to strike anything that Member Kaminsky nor Member Kirschenbaum already said, it was to amend the.
So you just want to add two sentences before the.
Correct.
Ensure that there are safeguards to the, okay, I think I have it. All right. We need to get this moving. So I would like to vote on Matt's amendment to the amendment, please.
You have it, right? Because I didn't catch all of it.
Yeah, I think, yes.
You have it, right?
Yes, I think we have it.
Member Beardmore?
Point of order. Clarification. Can you please read the amendment that we are voting on right now? The amendment to the amendment, please. Thank you.
The committee charges the policy subcommittee with reviewing policies to ensure they meet the needs of all students and making recommendations for policy revisions, additions, or deletion to the committee to ensure that there are safeguards in place in selecting academic course sequences.
Thank you.
All right, we are ready to vote.
Member Beardmore?
Beardmore, yes.
Member Brennan?
Brennan, yes.
Member Dubois?
Dubois, yes.
Member Gustafson?
Gustafson, no.
Member Kaminsky?
Kaminsky, yes.
Member Kirschenbaum?
Kirschenbaum, yes.
Member Lavoy?
Lavoy, yes.
Member Lorway?
Lorway, no.
Member Otmar?
Otmar, yes.
Member Poole?
Poole, yes.
Member Wallace?
Wallace, yes.
Member Samengarrett?
Samengarrett, yes.
Member Winters?
Winters, yes.
Member Woodland?
Woodland, no.
Chair Renstrom?
The chair abstains and the motion passes. All right, so this is going to sound nutty, but we actually have to vote on the exact same wording again because we just amended it. We amended the amendment, but now it's the amendment as amended. So we have to vote on the amendment. I know, this is crazy, but we're voting on exactly the same language we just voted on again.
Is this the one that Member Kirschenbaum made?
Yes, but it's been amended, so it's the same exact language that I just read.
Member Beardmore? Member Brennan?
Brennan, yes.
I'm sorry?
Yes.
Member Dubois?
Dubois, yes.
Member Gustafson?
Gustafson, no.
Member Kaminsky?
Kaminsky, yes.
Member Beardmore?
Beardmore, yes.
Member Lavoy?
Lavoy, yes.
Member Kirschenbaum?
Kirschenbaum, yes.
Member Lorway?
Lorway, no.
Member Samengarrett?
Samengarrett, yes.
Member Wallace?
Wallace, yes.
Member Poole?
Poole, yes.
Member Winters?
Winters, yes.
Member Woodland?
Woodland, no.
Chair Renstrom?
The chair abstains and the motion passes. All right, stay with me. We have to vote a third time on the exact same
thing. Member Otmar votes yes.
Oh, sorry, we missed Member Otmar. All right. So we need to vote on the exact same language a third time because now we're actually at the motion. So same, it should. Well, I'm not telling you how to vote. We're voting on the same exact language as the last two votes. Let's call the vote. Oh, sorry, there's
Shouldn't
a...
Shouldn't we discuss it now that the amendment...
Yes, actually, you may. Yes, absolutely. Sorry. Sorry, I apologize. We can't vote yet. Is there any discussion on the motion as amended?
So,
Member Poole.
I would just like to say that I think that this now is whether we should actually charge the policy committee with doing this right now rather than waiting for... our strategic plan and anything else that might come in line. So it's not necessarily the wording, which I think is fine. It's do we actually want to charge them with doing that right now?
Yes, you are absolutely correct. You could support the wording, but you could, like for instance, a motion to delay it or something would be in order,
sure.
Anything like that. We're taking up the full motion, but the wording is what we just agreed to. Yes, so is there any discussion? Malia.
I am opposed to the motion, even as amended. I think that we're putting the cart before the horse. I think there are, I think this is, we have a new subcommittee with a specific charge that might include this. And obviously they've heard all of this discussion, so they may inform their work by some of the questions that have come up in the subcommittee. I think especially because the particular situation that has driven this is being resolved in other ways. I think I'm very nervous about us charging a subcommittee with creating a new policy every time there is a situation that might be able to be resolved some other way or clarified some other way. And I would also like the policy subcommittee to have leeway to start their work with a clean slate and bring to us what they think is relevant in terms of how they work. So I think it's a bit premature to be sending this particular motion to them.
Okay. Further discussion on the motion? Did someone have their hand up?
Yes.
Dana, go ahead.
Thank you. As I said before, I would like to reiterate that I'm reluctant to charge my colleagues with doing their job when I'm confident that they will, in fact, be doing their job in the policy subcommittee. And I'd like to give them the leeway and the time to do their work.
Thank you. Any further discussion? We're now ready to go to a roll call vote on the motion.
Member Lorway?
Lorway, no.
Member Lavoy?
Lavoy, yes.
Member Kirschenbaum?
Kirschenbaum, abstain.
Member Kaminsky?
Kaminsky, yes.
Member Poole?
Poole, no.
Member Beardmore?
Beardmore, yes.
Member Otmar?
Otmar, yes.
Member Wallace?
Wallace, yes.
Member Winters?
Winters, yes.
Member Dubois?
Dubois, no.
Member Woodland?
Woodland, no.
Member Gustafson?
Gustafson, no.
Member Brennan?
Brennan, no.
Member Salmon Garrett?
Salmon Garrett, no.
Chair Runstrom?
The chair abstains and the motion fails. All right, moving on. Treasurer's report and financial statement. We received the treasurer's report this morning, and I believe it's in your red folders. Questions about the treasurer's report should be directed to the business and finance subcommittee. Questions about financial statements should be directed to the business director. All right, the next item is CPAC report. Liaisons were just appointed today, but I believe Member Lavoy has an update from CPAC.
I do. I have a quick update. CPAC will be distributing an end-of-year survey out this week. So community feedback is invaluable, and they look forward to hearing from stakeholders with their thoughts, experience with WRSD special ed programs and services. CPAC also expressed concern, and I think this was addressed a little bit, but more for Dr. Riley, on impact of students with IEPs on the move to trimesters. And there's a meeting tomorrow with special education administration, and CPAC will have at least one school committee representative there. We'll report back after that.
Thank you. Moving on to subcommittee reports. So again, subcommittee members were only appointed a few hours ago, so I don't expect anyone necessarily to have reports, except maybe business and finance, who has been meeting. So Member Brennan, anything from business and finance?
Sure. Business and finance has had two meetings, and they mostly pertain to discussion of the treasurer and assistant treasurer and the hiring process and contracts. And that's pretty much what we've discussed about.
Okay. So again, no pressure if you don't have an update, but we'll go through it. Legal affairs, anything? Nope. Superintendent goals and evaluation? Nope.
Nope.
Facilities and security? No. Audit advisory? No. Policy? You haven't even formed yet, so I wouldn't expect you to have anything. Do we have any school council reports? Member Kirschenbaum.
Thank you. I would just like to say, thank you to the administration at Mountview Middle School for a successful year. And I would also say that they're having their music concerts tonight. I'm here instead of there. But I trust that that the students enjoyed their experience, and I'm sure that the parents were pleasantly surprised. It's nice to see that the program is rebounding after, you know, so many years. So. And COVID. So it's nice to see the arts celebrated. And then I would also say congratulations to all the eighth graders that are stepping out of the middle school and entering into their high school years. So that's all.
Thank you. Any other school council reports? Seeing none, moving on to new business. Do we have any new business this evening?
Yes, we do.
Member Lorway, go ahead.
Before I bring up new business, please tell me again what the next meeting this month will consist of, because I was hoping that my new business would be addressed at that meeting.
No, we'll probably take it up at the July meeting, Dana.
Okay, I don't like the probably in there because I have been working on this for some time. I would like to propose as new business an amendment to policy relating to education special needs, P3811A, which would add the state definition of dyslexia and of learning disabilities to the policy, stating that these are the definitions that we use in this district when assessing the special education needs of students. I will be happy to circulate those definitions and policy to the body. Mr. Chairman, I believe you already have this information from me.
Yeah, I think I saw your email this afternoon. So yeah, you brought it up under new business. You sent me the motion with rationale. So I would expect it to be on the agenda for the next meeting. Thank you, Dana. Any other new business?
What do you mean by next meeting, Mr. Chairman?
The July meeting.
Thank you.
Yes.
This is more a question of operations. Is it appropriate for members to make a motion like that with a new policy subcommittee, or is this something that we would bring to a policy subcommittee?
So we can decide that at the next meeting. So right now, we don't discuss new business, but a member has had new business that they'd like to be put on an agenda, and that's a valid request. Yes. We'll take it up next, and we can decide what to do with it at the next meeting.
Yes.
Any other new business? All right, having completed all business on the agenda for this evening, I declare this meeting is adjourned.